welcome. You are watching a special edition of Property Hotline. I'm Kavita Krishnan. Like you know, 2016 has been a bit of a roller coaster ride for the real estate sector. We started this year, of course, with a lot of hope. Markets were turning around, the buyer was back in the market, and interest rates were coming off after a long, long time. But all of that has changed toward the year end. Right now, as we speak, the buyer, the investor, both are confused. They do not know what to do. They do not know whether they should stay invested, but they do not know whether they should go out and buy. And that is precisely why we've lined up a stellar power-packed panel of experts for you to answer all of your questions. In the studio with me today is Jayashree Kurup. Jayashree heads content and research at Magicbricks.com. She'll be answering all the questions that you have regarding buying, selling and investing in Realty in 2017. We have Harsh Roongta with us. He is a SEBI registered investment advisor who is going to answer all your home finance questions. And of course, joining me also is Vinay Singh. Vinay is a legal and a tax expert, and he's going to answer all your legal queries, all your tax issues related to your purchase or investment in real estate in the new year. Let's get started. Welcome to the show, all of you. And let's get started with this question that's come in from Govind from Delhi. Now, Govind wrote in to us on email and he told us that he's been an avid viewer of Magicbricks Now. And he has invested in 3 properties after taking advice from experts on our show. Now, Govind has another question to ask us. He wants to invest in a 2-BHK apartment somewhere in Sector 76, Noida. His budget is 1 crore rupees and he wants to know if this is a good investment. Should he hold on to it? Jayashree, what would you say? This is somebody who's already taken our advice 3 times earlier.
Yes. First of all, I think we have to say thank you, Govind, for being such a loyal viewer. And the second thing is that, yes, Sector 71 to 78 has been one of the very good sectors of Noida for end user buyers. Its social infrastructure is good, good developers in that market. And I think if you're 76, there's nothing wrong. The metro is going to be very close to you. So it's a good sector to buy in. Now, as far as is it a good time to buy? Of course, it's a good time to buy. Because for 2 years, the markets have been flat. The values had more or less corrected themselves. And, with demonetization, what I can see in the Delhi NCR market is, please do not go with expectations of 30 to 40% drop in prices. I think that's unrealistic. The markets cannot sustain that kind of level, considering the construction cost and so on. But I do see an 8 to 10% negotiation happening, and if you're an end user and a serious buyer, the seller is willing to sit across a table and negotiate with you. Now, let me tell you what you can get in 1 crore in Sector 76. You can get a 3-BHK apartment for about 1400 to about 1800, and you can get 2-BHK apartments for about 88 lakh. So clearly, your budget is fine. You can get 2 or 3 BHK apartments. And if you buy that, you should be able to get a rental return of roughly about 12,000 to 18,000, depending on which developer's property you've bought. So if you buy today, there is rental demand. These are good sectors to live in, and you will be able to get a return on your investment. I expect that this should go up in about 5 to 7 years. Anyone who's buying into the market today, please understand that earlier you used to get, in 5 years you would get a good return. Now you need to hold it for at least 7 and a half years. That's our estimate according to what we've understood from the experts.
Right, and look at the prices in Sector 76. It's averaging around 5,012 rupees per square foot, up 1% in the last 1 year. Of course, don't get spooked by how the prices have moved. Prices have largely stayed flat in this market through the year. I would like to bring in Harsh over here. And Harsh, you know what I'm going to ask you. He's already invested in three properties, and he's looking at a 4th investment. Considering what is happening in the market, Jayashree did say it's a great market to get into. But would you recommend that he probably waits it out for the first 6 months of the year and then goes ahead with that investment?
See, I think there's nothing wrong, obviously, as Jayashree has said, with the investment per se. But it may or may not be right for this gentleman simply because I think there is such a thing as balancing your investment portfolio. So clearly, if already you are into three properties, unless you have a huge portfolio, those three properties are likely to be a very large percentage of your investable surplus. Do you really want to, and maybe he's probably talking of taking a loan, I don't really know. Do you really want to add on the same asset class, no matter how good the asset is? Do you really want to add on? So I think, again, those are some of the other things that he should look at. It has got nothing to do with the actual asset that he is thinking of buying. It is the asset class. Do you want to put all your eggs in right. one asset class? I think that's...
And once you've decided that, Govind, like Jayashree just told you, it is a great market that you have chosen, and you can actually expect good rental returns. It's a market that's getting a lot of rental interest. So you can expect rental returns between 12,000 to 18,000 rupees per month. So that is what you're essentially looking at. So take a call and make an informed decision. We now have a question from Shyam Sundar. He sent us an email. Now he says that he purchased a flat in Noida Extension in 2010. Now no construction was happening there when he booked the flat. It is a 1200 square feet flat. The property is ready, but the developer is now saying possession will be delayed by a year. Now Shyam Sundar was promised possession in December 2016 and he wants to know what should he do now. He also wants to know whether there are any tax implications in owning a second home. Vinay, would you want to take that?
Sure. I think when you're looking at the tax implication, we will take first. When you look at a second house, you're liable to be taxed on the basis of your notional rent, what the property would have earned as an income. So you will have to pay tax on that basis. But the good news is that you have a 30% deduction upfront from the gross rent, as well as whatever taxes you may be paying. And here is the real good thing, that any interest that you pay without any limit on your home loan that you use to buy the property is deductible completely. There are no limits of 2 lakhs or anything of the sort whatsoever. So that's as far as the tax is concerned. What was the first?
He has bought into this property, he says, which was supposed to be he was supposed to be given possession in December 2016. Right, and now the developer says, though the flat is ready, it's going to take another year.
There are normally your only recourse is to approach a consumer forum. But I would like to point out one thing to you. In Mumbai recently, there are a lot of criminal complaints being registered against builders for failure to give possession. And a couple of them have been sent to jail also for this thing. So it's a new trend where the commissioner of police has issued a circular saying that a criminal offense should be registered if there is a delay in possession. So you could look at this also at that end, because a criminal case does bring about a lot of pressure. So both these options are open to you. You can go to consumer forum. You also can go and try and get a criminal complaint registered for failure. Moreover, if you say that the property is ready and for some reason he's trying to delay it, if you can establish that it is ready and he's deliberately not giving it to you, I feel you would have a very good case here.
Right. But shouldn't he first go and have a conversation with the developer before going ahead and filing a case? And the other thing also, which is what typically happens in cases like this, is that a lot of times buyers are told, okay, if you're in a hurry to move in, you can. And I'm assuming here that the delay is probably because the OC has not come in over here. Jayashree, I want to bring you in here. Would you recommend that a buyer moves into a home in a situation like that?
No, Kavita. Actually, without an occupancy certificate, please do not move into that house. And there may be, while the structure may be ready, there should be a lot of finishing work that has to happen. Remember, these are multi-story apartments. You need your lifts in working order. You need maintenance of common areas. Security has to be in place. So just moving into a semi-complete apartment complex just because the unit is ready is not a good idea. There are very serious safety and fire fire implications, fire hazard implications. So I think you have to wait for that occupancy certificate. Put pressure on the developer. Join up with others who have bought. Clearly, if the unit is ready and it was to be delivered, there will be a lot of other harried consumers like you. Form a forum and start talking to the developer. That's happening in Noida, and many developers are actually responding to that and starting conversations about how soon they can deliver.
Right. So moving on from there to a question from Keval now. He asks us, what is the maximum loan available for a person earning 2.5 lakh rupees per annum? On what value of the property are loans sanctioned? What is the minimum rate of interest that banks offer? Why are interest rates high in practicality? And he also wants to know, why do people with lower salaries get lower loan amount? That, of course, Harsh, is a function of how much you can repay, right?
Absolutely. So I think the last question answers itself, right? I mean, although consumers do have this query that if I have a higher value property, why do you need to even check my income? But the issue is that you do not repay a loan by selling property. You repay a loan from your income. And that is why your income has a direct bearing on the amount of loan that you can get. Typically, of the income that you have, banks assume that roughly 40-45%, in some cases up to 50% of that income is available for giving it out or paying back the loan amount, and it is calculated accordingly. So to answer Keval's question, he, I think, in the beginning mentioned that his income was 2.5 lakhs. Assuming that is his net income, assuming he's eligible for a 20-year loan, which means he's less than 40 years old, typically, I think he should be able to get a loan of 4 times his net salary, net annual salary. So roughly 10 lakhs is the loan that he should be able to get. To get a 10 lakh loan based on his income, the property typically would have to be at least 11 lakhs. For loans below 20 lakhs, the loan to agreement, loan to value ratios can be 90%. So if the property is valued at 11 lakhs, maybe he is technically eligible for a loan of 10 lakhs based on the income that he has shown. I think as far as loan rates are concerned, I mean, loan rates are market-driven, so I have not really understood what he means by saying
that. But what's your outlook? We are already seeing a lot of banks, you know, coming up with interest rate cuts. They've been announcing that as we've neared the end of the year. Do you see rates further softening from here on? Will we have cheaper home loans in the new year?
So, Kavita, the easiest prediction at this time to make is that home loan rates are going to drop. It's a very easy prediction to make. The key issue is, it's very difficult to answer that, but I would suspect there is going to be a lot of pressure on the public sector banks, right, particularly from the government to drop rates. And if the public sector banks drop rates, their private sector counterparts will have to follow. So, I mean, at the very least, I would expect a 20-25 basis points drop, maybe even a half a percent drop. The point is, yes, it would drop maybe in 2 months, 3 months' time. But a home loan is a 20-year engagement. During that period, your loan rates are going to go up and down. Please remember that. So I think this whole obsession with interest rates, what they are at the time when you start the loan, while that is good, just please remember that you have
You'll
a 20-year
period. You need to be prepared,
Keval,
for future shocks. And on the screen right now, we are, of course, showing you the rate of interest that banks are giving, the MCLR rates, and the rates of the HFC home finance companies as well. Remember, of course, that these are the rates that the bank has decided. Now, how much, on what rate of interest they'll give you the loan, this will be a they will, of course, add a couple of basis points to this particular rate and then lend to you. Very quickly, Vinay, he has a 2.5 lakh rupee per annum salary, and we are assuming that he will, of course, look to buying a home that costs less than 20 lakh rupees. Given that, are there any tax breaks that you get for buying affordable homes?
Yes, you would get some benefit in the form of a lower interest rate. But that's about it. And, you know, as Harsh said, that it's a long-term thing. So right now it may be a 1% benefit to you, but over a long period, you don't know where it will go. So you have to bear that in mind.
Right. So you will get no special tax breaks there. But of course, there are a lot of and banks are giving much cheaper home loans to people who buy homes that are priced less than 20 lakh rupees. So you need to go to your bank and check exactly what you're being offered. And of course, do ensure that you check with at least 4 or 5 banks before zeroing in on one banker. We have Vadekar, who sent in a question from Pune Now through email. He wants to know more about Lodha Belmondo, that is located on the Mumbai-Pune Expressway in Pune. This, he says, is for investment purpose. Budget is 80 lakh to 1 crore rupees. He wants to know if this is a good project to invest in. If not, what are the other projects that he can consider? Jayashree, that stretch, the Punavale stretch near Lodha Belmondo has seen a lot of development. What would you say? Is it a good area to invest in?
See, Kavita, there has been a lot of premium properties on this stretch. It's extremely scenic. Earlier, it was all holiday and weekend homes. It is about 20 minutes drive from Pune and about 2 hours from Mumbai. So, would somebody buy there and drive to Pune every day? Unless you are crazy about suburban living, you may not do that. You will still say that, let me buy a little closer to the city, because there are traffic jams when you move into the city. As a weekend home, yes, it is a good option, either from Mumbai and or Pune, and we see a lot of interest from both these areas. It has 1 to 5 BHK, so the choice is yours. If it's a premium home that you're looking to stay in and then live there regularly, then you may want to buy a larger apartment. It is roughly about 80 lakh to a crore, where you can get 2 BHK flats of about 1300 to about 1800 square feet. Larger apartments are also available. It is connected to schools, colleges, bus stops, hospitals, malls. It's not that it's in the middle of the wilderness. It's closer to the established areas. And currently, it's the average rate in this project is about 6,800. And with a developer like Lodha, you don't need to query the developer's pedigree. That's quite obviously there. So if you're looking for other options here, size 2 BHK will also be available. Let me quickly put it in perspective. You can get about 45,000 rent for an apartment like this. Now that is a big return, and it is that is something that you may want to consider.
Right. And you know, Jayashree, I'm looking at the rates over here, that the average rate in this area is around 6,678 rupees per square foot, and your own data shows us that it's gone up 46% in the last 1 year, which is a huge, huge, huge increase. Of course, it must have come on a low base. But talk to us about this area and why is it seeing this kind of growth?
Yeah. Kavita, suburban, areas that are at touching distance to the city, which are extremely scenic, which offer, typically suburban living, seems to be picking up on the periphery of most of our cities. It's like this, do you want another apartment in the middle of the city, or do you want something that where you could probably drive away and spend the weekend in? And I suspect that craving for getting away on the weekends seems to be what is driving this kind of interest rather than buying another unit in the city.
So, what you're essentially saying is that it would actually make sense to consider buying a second home, a holiday home, on the outskirts of the city. And at what distance should it be ideally from the city to see this kind of growth?
Not more than an hour, about 45 minutes to an hour. Those are the homes that are seeing this kind of appreciation. If it is about 2 hours from the city, then you are subject to traffic jams and things like that. I think more than anything else, Kavita, this has to be scenic. This has to be, once you reach there, it should be idyllic. And that's the kind of homes that's picking up. And one thing that helps it is that the values have been flat for 2 years and the affordability of these homes has gone up.
Right. For all those who are interested in suburban living, that should come as good news. If you want to live close to the city, but not close to the traffic, then it's probably time for you to go and buy that home that you've set your eye on prices are moving up and prices seem to be moving up very fast in that particular segment of the market because demand is on the rise. We have a question from Parimala now. She asks us if NRIs who have availed housing loans can avail IT benefit as well. How can they get tax benefits, Vinay?
Well, they are subject to the same laws as a local Indian is. If you are filing your tax returns here and you have a property here, you have a home loan here, you would be entitled to the same benefits, which is single house up to self-occupied up to 2 lakhs. And if it's other than that, it's a deemed let out or a let out property, then your interest you can claim without any limit.
Right. And do they have to, you know, furnish any specific documentation, etc.? Or it is just the same kind of documentation that any Indian would have to
It's find? The same documentation, essentially a certificate from the institutions certifying that this is the principal repayment and this is the interest paid during the year. So on the basis of that certificate, you can claim.
There you go, Parimala. You have the same benefits, the same IT benefits as any resident Indian. Question from Dhanush next. He stays in Ville Parle East. Now, his mother's tenanted building has been redeveloped recently and the society has been formed. Now, the society accepted the 2014 bylaws, but his mother wants him to be an associate member. However, the secretary says that he needs to be the co-owner of the flat and cannot pay just ₹100 and become an associate member. He asks us if such things exist under the law. Vinay, this is right up your alley. You've been doing a lot of this, lot of work on housing societies.
Well, the model bylaws of 2014 is anything but model. It's one of the worst documents that I have ever come across in my life. Let us start with this particular issue, where a simple thing like the definition of an associate member, as is given in the bylaws, is at odds with what is given in the Act itself. The Act does not lay down any condition which says that an associate member must be a co-owner of the property. Quite obviously, the bylaws are subservient to the Act and they cannot override the Act. So they have inserted a definition there in the bylaws which says that an associate member is a person who holds the shares jointly and who has a share in the property. Quite obviously, this is illegal and cannot be enforced. So I would suggest that you ask the secretary to study the Act and he will satisfy himself that what does the Act say, who is an associate member, and if necessary, you take a legal opinion on whether this associate member needs to be a property owner or not. So as far as I can see, your mother can become an associate member you can become an associate member without any need to holding any share in the property whatsoever.
Right. So seek legal opinion. You can become an associate member without being a co-owner of that property. We have Ganesh who sent in a question from Bengaluru. Now he says that he shifted his loan from Axis Bank to SBI. He has opted for property insurance since he was told it is mandatory. Now the cost of the property is 85 lakh rupees. The outstanding loan to SBI is 30 lakh rupees. Now since he's transferred the loan, what should the insurance cover? Should it cover 85 lakh rupees or 30 lakh rupees? We will of course answer that, but Harsh, we've had this discussion a lot of times before. Banks say that it is mandatory that you buy insurance. Is it mandatory to buy that insurance from the bank?
So it's illegal for the bank to say that you have to mandatorily buy the insurance from them. It is all right if their business rules say that you have to have insurance, and I think that's for the protection of both the borrower and the bank.
So what you're saying is it's not even mandatory to buy the insurance cover?
Obviously not. There is no regulations that require buying, but bank in its own wisdom while laying down its own policies regarding loans may lay down that it will not give a loan unless and until there is sufficient insurance cover. Regulations clearly provide that should a bank have this requirement, they cannot insist that that particular kind of insurance be bought only from them. Now that is the law. In practice, it is completely and openly flouted. I think the only way to get rid of this is a competitive market out there. If somebody is pushing a dud insurance product at you, I mean, essentially they are trying to extract more revenue from rather than just the interest. Mm-hmm. Just shift your loan. There are plenty of players out
He's
there.
He's already shifted his loan.
You can shift it again or while shifting, negotiate. Because that is your best time to negotiate. I think his other question was, what is the insurance cover? It ties back to the first one. Please study your policy document. For all you know, that policy document lapses moment the loan to SBI is paid off. So don't assume that the policy document will continue.
No, what he wants to know is, now that he shifted the loan amount is only 30 lakh rupees. That is the outstanding that he has to pay back to SBI.
Right.
So should the insurance cover the 30 lakh rupees or should it cover 85 lakh, which was the actual loan value?
So the point is, if he is thinking that whether the old policy that he had bought, I think there is a third option that might be worth zero, because that might provide. And most of the tied policies that banks have, most of them provide that the policy will lapse if the loan is paid off, which it is in this case when the loan is shifted. So don't be so sanguine that it covers 30 also. For all you know, that policy is now worth zero. How much should it be? Obviously, if your insurance requirements are not arising just out of the loan. There is a lot more to your insurance requirement than just the loan. But if you are treating just the loan, then obviously your insurance requirement is only 30 lakhs. So, that's something
And very quickly, Harsh, if he does decide to take an insurance cover, is it advisable to take it from the bank? You said that it is not mandatory. Is it advisable to take it from the bank, or would you get a better deal if you were to buy it outside?
See, if you're perfectly healthy, everything is well with you, you will always get a much better policy outside. But sometimes it is just administratively more convenient to take it from the bank. People are extremely lazy about insurance. So rather than not have the insurance, it's better to have costlier insurance.
Right. So you will get costlier insurance from the bank is what you need to know. And if you want to ensure that you get a good deal, it is time for you to do your own homework, do your research, go back to the bank and say, you know what, I'm buying an insurance policy, but I'm not buying it from you. That's a call that you need to take at the end of the day. Question from Amar next. He wants to invest in a home in Sarjapur in Bangalore. His budget is 1.5 crore rupees. He's unsure whether he should choose Purvankara or Mantri. Also, should he buy a ready-to-move-in property or an under-construction property? Jayashree, a whole lot of questions there. He's got his location down. But what would you suggest? Purvankara or Mantri, under construction or ready to move in?
On Sarjapur Road, you have two Mantri properties and one Purvankara property. You've got Mantri Flora at Iblur Village, that's near Harlur. And here you will get a 3 BHK of about 1695 square feet at about 1.37 crore. Now, Mantri Glades, which is about 1680 to 2625, which is on Sarjapur Road near Kaikondra Halli. Now, both are ready to move in and you have to buy it from the secondary markets. We have plenty of listings available on our site for both these properties. You'll get about over 90 secondary market. So when you're buying from the secondary market, and you have to make sure that these are the title is clear, approvals are in place, person you're buying it from should have all the property documents that you need, and it's good to take a bank loan so that the bank does the due diligence of documentation. In terms of a choice between Purvankara and Mantri, they're both established developers, track record of delivery. So I think the next thing that you have to look at is which of them gives you a layout that you like better and which of them gives you the size, the carpet area size that you get, which one gives you one that is more convenient. But in terms of pedigree of developers, I would say both are good, and you're looking at Sarjapur Road. Also look at the actual location of the property on Sarjapur Road, because Sarjapur is a very long stretch of road. Whichever one is most convenient for you as a location, you should choose that. But otherwise, I think your choice is fairly okay.
Right, Amar. And what you would be better off doing, of course, and those are the rates of Sarjapur Road for you, 5,327 rupees per square foot, up 6% in the last 1 year. And of course, do consider where you work. It's best to live closer to where you work, especially if you're on Sarjapur Road, which we know is also a huge, huge traffic bottleneck. Jayashree, coming back to you, you did mention that he should be looking at the resale market. So, you've also been maintaining all in the last couple of weeks that it's if you are looking at the resale market, then you should be able to drive a good deal. These are the markets. This is where you will see prices under pressure because of demonetization. Is that true of Bangalore as well?
See, the Bangalore market, Kavita, had already started feeling the heat. The Bangalore market chugged along fairly steadily while the rest of the markets were going down. But over the last 6 months, even before demonetization, we had seen some stress in the Bangalore market.
Right, and those are the prices of Sarjapur Road again, and we will continue showing you prices from the Bangalore market. Jayashree, you were saying that the market has been facing some heat over the last couple of quarters.
Right. But after the demonetization, I think if you're a serious buyer and go with an intent to, I think this is a good time for you to negotiate in the secondary markets. Secondary markets have fewer sellers today than you had, say, 1 month ago. But the sellers who are the ones who want to exit, because one is not sure how long this pressure is going to continue on the markets, and there are many sellers who would rather sell off and exit the markets.
Right, so if you're looking at the secondary market, and that is where you should look at for the location and the projects that you have picked up, then you should also ensure that you drive yourself a good deal. Look for at least a 10% discount on the price that you're being asking. That's what Jayashree has been telling us for the past couple of weeks. Legal question from Rahul next. He asks if occupation certificate is applicable to a home constructed on a personally owned plot of land. Vinay, you need an OC for a home that you construct on your own?
Absolutely, you need an OC, because the OC is a very important document that finally certifies that whatever you have constructed is in accordance with the approved plan. And that, in a way, is a culmination of the entire construction process. You do, of course, have a final certificate, which is a completion certificate. But it is very important, because without this document, you aren't entitled to occupy the flat itself or the unit itself.
And you can't sell this, right? If you want to sell it in future, without the OC, is it possible to sell your flat?
It will be difficult, because technically, without the OC, in a sense, your structure would not be legal. Also, you would not be entitled to a water connection, an official water connection. So whatever water connection you may be given on compassionate grounds, you would be paying through your nose for water. You would also be paying much higher property taxes because you do not have an OC. Also, it is illegal for you to occupy it without an OC. So, you know, the sum total of all this is that your OC is a must, and you must occupy it only after you have received the OC.
Yes, you need to go and get an OC. And also one other thing, Vinay, I wanted to check with you. Now, if there are TDR or if there are FSI benefits in future come on that particular plot of land, on that particular property, even for that, you would require an OC if you want to exercise
Absolutely.
Those benefits.
Anything that you want to do on that piece of land, if you don't have an existing OC, you'll not be allowed to do.
So there you go. Those are all the reasons why you should be getting an OC. But the most important one, of course, is the OC is a certificate that your home is complete and your home is safe for you to move in. That is precisely why you need an OC. We have Suresh, who sent us a question. He says that he has a home loan of 13 lakh rupees and he wants to know if he can pledge gold, an avail loan from the bank, to pay back part of the home loan. Would you really advise that, Harsh?
Can he do it? Of course he can do it. Should he do it? I don't think so. I mean, loan against gold is more expensive than a regular home loan. I think the cheapest gold loan that he can think of definitely is more than the 9.15 or 9.25 rate that he pays on a home loan. If you are paying too high a rate on your home loan, shift your home loan rather than shifting the type of loan. So I think probably this is an old loan which is running at a high rate, and that's the reason he is thinking of a gold loan. Shift your home loan. That, I think, is a much better option.
Right. And to drive home that point further, if you're not just convinced by the fact that a gold loan will be costlier than a home loan which you're currently paying, Vinay, do you get any tax benefits on a gold loan?
That is the other point. You're not going to get any tax benefits whatsoever on your gold loan. So it is, as Harsh said, better to stick with the home loan. Find somebody else. Just move the loan to another institution and continue to enjoy the tax benefits and a lower rate both.
Right, Harsh, I can see that you want to come in.
I think on the tax benefits, I differ from Vinay. Tax benefit doesn't go by the nomenclature of the loan. As long as this gold loan is used to repay a loan that was taken to acquire a house, I think tax benefits can continue. It does not matter what is the property, what kind of security you have given for a loan or what it is called. I think what is important is that this gold loan, in this case, if he decides to go ahead, as long as he can show that the gold loan was used to repay an home loan, I think he will continue to be eligible for the deduction of interest. Should he do it? I don't.
It is a personal loan. The gold loan will become a personal loan. And the payment or that is not relevant, but the type of loan is relevant. So if it's a home loan only, then you are entitled to the benefits, not for personal loans.
So tell us this. What does the law, what does the taxman say? Now, if I do take a gold loan and I use it to pay off my home, you know, the cost of my home, and if I actually go and tell the taxman that, hey, you know what, I taken a loan, pledged my gold, taken a loan, paid it off, but it went towards my home. Is that enough? Do I need documentation? How do I convince the taxman?
See, the first year, possibly if you are paying back, you are paying interest, you would be entitled to claim whatever you paid as interest. Let us not worry about the source of your loan. But in subsequent years, you will continue to pay interest on your gold loan, and that will not be eligible for any deduction. That will essentially be your problem.
Okay, so you're saying you'll get it for 1 year, you won't get it for the...
I don't agree. I don't think there is any such provision in the Income Tax Act. I think the Income Tax Act clearly says...
Let's bring this back. Net, what do all of you say? Should he pledge his gold, take a loan and pay off his home loan? Does it look like a good decision to you, Jayashree?
No.
Absolutely.
I think on that there is unanimity.
Let me bring Jayashree in. Jayashree, what do you say? Do you think it makes sense here?
If you've taken a home loan, I think I would agree with the point of view that if you're paying a higher interest rate, shift your institution, don't shift the type of loan. Taking a personal loan and paying off a home loan seems a silly idea, actually, because home loan, there are many benefits given to the consumer. And those benefits will cease if you're going to put down that loan using a personal loan. That's not a good idea. I think I would go with what Vinay is saying and say that shift the institution, get the benefit, and the benefits of home loan, interest rates, principal repayments are all going to be enhanced in the future. So I think you should stick to the home loan and not put it down.
Well, that's your thought, Jayashree. That's something we will discuss sometime into the show. But Suresh, the verdict is very clear. Do not take a loan against gold to pay off a home loan. It really doesn't make sense. If you have gold which you can pledge and take a loan, you can use that loan for something else, probably for a world tour. Joseph sends us a question through email now. He says that he owns a 1 BHK flat in Dombivli and the price of a 1 BHK in Dombivli currently is around 43 lakh, he says. However, the best price he has received for this property is 32 lakh rupees only. Now, he's unsure if he should hold or sell. He's hearing that prices might decrease due to demonetization. What should he do? Jayashree, you've been answering this for the past few weeks. He does not tell us which area it is in, which project it is in. What do you say? What should he do?
Kavita, I studied the Dombivli market and there is a range of property values that are there. You can sell a house, 1 BHK for 21 lakhs. You can sell a 1 BHK for 42 or even up to 55 lakhs. And that is because the Lodha properties, the Pallava properties, these are the ones that are commanding much better returns from the consumer because they perform better than the market. Now, he hasn't told us which property he has, but if he hasn't got 42, every property in Dombivli, every 1 BHK in Dombivli will not command 42 lakh. So don't use a locality average, only use that to beg whether you're in the range. Do not expect the highest value in the locality to come to your property. That's the first thing. The second one is that right now there is so much confusion in the market. Kavita, we've been saying again and again, this is not a seller's market. If you need that money very desperately, please go ahead and check it out. But I don't think sellers are getting the best value. You can put your property on sale, figure out what other properties in your own development is fetching. And a good way of doing that is come to the site, go to Magicbricks, check out, put all the details of your property and use the prop worth calculator. It will tell you what your property is worth using a benchmark average. Use that to start negotiating. But remember that right now, 2 years, the markets have been flat. Values are down. They have not risen. Indexed to inflation, values actually have gone down. And since demonetization, the number of buyers in the market have actually gone down. It's not that people don't want to buy. People are waiting to see how the market will play out. I think at least for 2 months, if you can wait as a seller and wait to let the market unfold, I think that will be a good thing to do.
Right. And Jayashree, you very clearly said that do not take the average rate as a benchmark. Now, this is for all the viewers who are tuning in. We're looking at the Dombivli rates right now. It's 6,314 rupees per square foot and has gone up 5% in the last 1 year. Of course, this is an average price, like Jayashree just pointed out. It is from her own data. Jayashree, tell us this. Now, when you are looking to sell a property or buy a property in a particular micro market, what kind of variation should you be okay with? You know, how much more and how much lesser than the average is a fair enough window to be in?
Kavita, a market normally functions on an average, on a range in the middle, the median range. There will be properties that are maybe smaller, maybe older, maybe badly kept, which where the values are lower. And we consider those the aberrations, the outliers, but those do exist in the market. Similarly, there will be one or two properties which outperform the market, maybe because they are very well-managed townships, the concept of the whole property is good, the social infrastructure is excellent, maybe it does not have any traffic snarls in that area, and all this contributes to the rising prices. So if you look at, you know, if there are 20 properties, a good way to look at the averages, if there are 20 properties listed, you will find that the whole spectrum is, like I said, about 21 lakh to about 42, 45 lakh. That would be the entire spectrum. Knock off the one or two properties that have been fetching the maximum values and the one or two properties that are fetching the lowest values. Now see what the range is. That is the average range in a range of average values of frequently traded properties. Now, if your property is actually decrepit or old or not very well maintained, you can expect it to fall below the median average. And if your property is really premium or well kept, do make sure that you can ask for the higher than the median values. But whatever you do, as a seller, you must be furnished with the details of why you are asking for the lower value or the higher value.
Right. And that's how you arrive at a valuation of your property. You got it from the expert herself. But also one big thing that came out from what Jayashree just told us is that if you are a seller, if you are looking to sell in a market, and especially in a market like this, where it is very difficult to sell a property, ensure that your property is well kept, well maintained. That itself is half your job done. The rest, of course, is convincing the buyer to give you the price that you are asking for it. We have a question from Pramod next. He says that he bought a home with Pardesi developers in 2010 in Kundli near Sonpat. Now, the possession was supposed to be given in 2014. The agreement does not contain a date of possession. Payment schedule said that the final installment was supposed to be given by the end of December 2013. He asks us if he's eligible to ask the developer for penalty. The agreement does not have a penalty clause even. He's currently staying in a rented house. Also, when he visited the site, he found some discrepancies in the construction. Vinay, I think he's been taken for a royal ride here. What can he do?
Just briefly, I would like to mention what he should have done. He should have got the agreement checked from a lawyer. We are saying this again and again that people are not taking this seriously when they are getting into a project, but do take a look at the agreement, show it to somebody and ensure that these type of clauses are there. What is the possession date? What will happen if you don't give me possession? You know, what happens if there's a delay? So the way I see it is that yes, you are entitled to compensation. In fact, you are also probably entitled to compensation because you are paying rent, whereas your possession, etc., has been delayed. But to get these benefits, you would have to go to a consumer forum, lodge your case there, and ask for all this compensation from there. Because in a regular court, it will be difficult if, you know, the conditions are not part of your agreement. But consumer forums tend to lean towards the consumer. Obviously, that's what they are there for. So you stand a much better chance of getting some justice there.
Right. And before we move on, Vinay, what are the things that are mandatorily part of the agreement that you sign? What are the things that you need to look out for? Also, as far as the possession date is concerned, does it suffice if the developer tells you, I will give you your home in December of 2017 or December of 2018? Or should he say, I'll give it to you on the 25th of December 2018?
See, the developer does put down a date quite often. This is strange that there is no date there. But there's a whole host of escape routes, you know. He will put a force majeure clause and say, if cement is not available, if labor is not available, if this is not available, then I'm not bound to stick to the deadline. Now, here is where you need to tighten things up. If he's giving you a commitment, it's not your business whether he could procure labor or cement or not. That's his problem. It's not your problem. So there should be a date by which he agrees to give you possession. There also should be a clear-cut understanding that if he fails to give by that date, what kind of compensation is to be paid by him to you? Because if you do miss one installment, he has this whole arsenal of weapons he can use against you. He'll charge you interest, he'll charge you penalty, he'll cancel the agreement.
If you just have to list it down, what are the things that should be there in your agreement?
Well, you must, of course, you need to check out the title. You must make sure that the title is clear. You must make sure that his plans are in place. No pre-construction thing. The plans have to be approved. You must make sure that your possession date is clearly mentioned. You must make sure that he mentions when he's going to form the society or the condominium. You must also make sure that he mentions when he's going to convey the property, at what stage he's going to convey the property. So these are important things that you must make sure are there. Also, whatever compensation is to be payable, paid by him for failure to meet these deadlines should be enumerated there.
Right, and it goes without saying that the flat number, if you're buying into an apartment complex, the flat number, the wing number, the building number, that should be mentioned clearly in your agreement. Also, the area of the flat, the carpet area, and if this transaction is being done on built-up area, which, by the way, is not supposed to be done, then you need to know what is the built-up area and what is the carpet area that you're getting. These are things that should be part of your agreement. We have Praveen now, who sent in a question through email. And he says that he wants to book a flat in pre-launch and take a home loan for it. He does not want to opt for the pre-EMI option, however. He asks us if it is possible for him to start EMI after possession and to pay the interest and the principal amount together. Harsh, is any bank going to wait for him to get possession?
First of all, if it's a pre-launch, means all the approvals are not in place. I can't think of a bank that will be willing to give a loan for a pre-launch buy. He should think twice before buying on pre-launch. I mean, so that is one. You're not going to get a loan. I mean, that is simple, definitely, because you can't register the agreement. You can't register the purchase. If you can't register the purchase, you're not going to be able to get a loan, which means pre-EMI, non-pre-EMI, everything is not possible. After a bank gives the loan, let's assume it's not pre-launch, let's assume all the approvals are in place and the bank is willing to give a loan. After that, the bank would have to be paid interest. It will either be paid interest by the consumer or by the developer. These are all those famous 20, 80, 5, 65, 5, 95, all these schemes that you see are typically many times also involve the bank, where the interest during the construction period is met by the
Harsh, and very
developer.
Quickly, I remember just opening the newspaper today and saying 20, you know, there was a huge ad saying 28, 17, welcome. And 17 is, you know, erased out and it says 2080 scheme. Since these schemes are still in the market, very quickly, can you tell us what are the risks in the scheme and how will this affect your profile as a creditor?
So first of all, read these schemes extremely carefully. Most of them are not really what they make themselves out to be. A typical good 2080 scheme is where you pay whatever is the upfront, 20% now, balance without any conditions are payable on possession. Now that's a decent 2080 scheme where you don't, at least your construction risk is mitigated. Moment you have that this balance amount either is paid by the bank, which is given as a loan, and the interest on that is paid by the developer. If for any reason the developer defaults, it is the buyer's liability to pay that interest. If he does not pay, his credit rating is going to be affected. If the developer delays payment of interest, it is the credit history of the buyer that is going to be affected. Very, very few schemes are good schemes. So, I mean, if I was to give a one-word advice, I would say avoid.
Yes, Praveen, and even I have just one word for you, and I believe my entire panel will be with me when I tell you this: run. You just have to run away from this particular deal that you're getting. Let's move on to a question that's coming through email from Ashok. Now, he says that he wants us to tell him our views on Mud Island as an investment destination and as a place to stay. Jayashree, let me bring you in here. Lots of interesting things happening in and around Mud Island. We know that there's a coastal road coming up over there. Will that up the profile from a weekend location where people in Mumbai go to picnic on the beach?
Right now, I think, Kavita, there are 1 BHK apartments. So I can see them listed on my site. And I can see that they are 21, 22 lakh. There are some that are much more expensive. But by and large, Mud Island is still a tourist destination. If the coastal road comes up, yes, it can become... It can be a place where you can buy and stay, but I don't think that's going to be a very easy option and a very short-term option. It may continue to remain a tourist destination because from the Vikhroli side, when you go from the link road, the Jogeshwari link road, and then you go via Borivali, I can see that every person I have spoken to has said that there is a huge endless traffic jam. Just easing that traffic jam with a link road may be a long-term option. I don't know whether I would advise a small retail investor to purchase a property saying that there is a long-term solution. It's still not on people's wish lists as a primary destination.
Right. Still not on people's wish list as a primary destination. And really, the coastal road is still on paper as we still speak. There are permissions that are coming in. There is a lot of push and pull over there. So we really have no clarity about the coastal road. So as of now, if you're looking for a holiday home, it's a great place. Otherwise, you do well to stay away from that particular market. But of course, this was the last question that we had to answer on today's special edition of Property Hotline. But before we conclude, the one word that stays with us as we end this year and as we step into the next year is, of course, the D word, the demonetization word. And that has had a huge impact on the real estate market. Let's get in the good news first. We've seen home loan rates come off. Harsh, what is your outlook for 2017? Do you see rates going further down? Will my home loan become cheaper in 2017? Thanks to the fallout of demonetization, the banks are sitting on a lot of cash.
I think it is bound to happen. I think the amount can be questioned, but I think a 0.25 over 6 months, a 0.25 to maybe even 0.5%, it depends on international developments as well. But a 0.25 to 0.5% drop in interest rates definitely on the cards.
0.25 to 0.5% drop. What about you, Vinay? What do you say? As far as taxes are concerned, we are looking at a situation where GST will probably be rolled out next year. The impact on real estate is still not very clear. But having said that, and Jayashree mentioned it at the beginning of the show, there is a demand now for the government to actually hike the exemption that we get on home loans in the budget. Are you hearing that as well? What is your outlook?
Well, I have not really heard anything major. There are a lot of rumors in the market, including that income tax itself may be scrapped. But that remains to be seen whether how true this is. I don't really see too much of a change, to be honest with you, in this particular area. Interest rates, yes, definitely they'll go down. But on the taxation front, I don't see anything major happening.
Don't see any major changes on the taxation front. What about GST? How is that going to impact? Anything that you're hearing on that?
That's still unclear, and we are all still waiting for some more clarity on how it will be implemented and what the final rate will be. So I suggest that we wait and watch what happens.
Wait and watch for GST. Jayashree, you've been talking to the housing ministry very often, and you've also been studying the market. First, tell us what you're hearing on the tax front, and then we will take your outlook on the market.
Even this morning, Minister for Housing, Venkaiah Naidu, has hinted that there is going to be a softening of tax rates for housing. So I would actually think that the budget should give us a direction, the budget on February 1st. But in terms of home loan interest rates, I think definitely 8.5% it should drop to, because there's a lot of liquidity in the system, not enough offtake. So I expect that 8.5% it should touch. We've had that before in the 2003 regime. We've had to 8.5% to 8.75%. I think that those rates are likely to come back, and that should boost the market. Tax, I think they will use tax drops as a only for the affordable housing segment. I don't see that happening across the board.
Actually, very quickly, I'm running out of time here. If I am looking to enter the market now, as a buyer, should I buy? As an investor, should I get in?
Yes. In both cases, it's a yes. But if you're an investor, buy into those markets which have strong commercial drivers, which have strong rental demand, and which are in early cycles of development, so that you can expect your money to grow and stay there for at least 7 years.
So that's the verdict there. Little clarity on the tax front. However, do expect home loan rates to come off. You could possibly see home loan rates touching 8.5% to 8.75% by the end of next year. And of course, like Jayashree just pointed out, if you are a buyer, if you are an investor, good time to enter the market at this point in time. It is not a seller's market. If you are looking to sell something, wait for at least 6 months. But if you are looking to buy or invest, good time to invest in real estate. However, do remember that you cannot do that in black anymore. Thank you very much, Jayashree, Vinay and Harsh, for coming in. With that, we do come to an end of this very special episode of Property Hotline. But we will be available to help you with answers to all your questions related to real estate through the year. Thanks for watching.
You can watch live TV on our website mbnow.in. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbricksnow. And don't forget to click the like button. You can also follow us on Twitter at magicbricksnow. To stay updated with all our programming, hit the subscribe button on our YouTube channel by logging on to youtube.com/magicbricksnow.